First of all, thanks a lot for inviting me here and letting me talk about the work that we are doing with smart grids in India. And I come with one single message for you today, and that is that you should stop. And this is especially important because we are in a technical university, and a lot of you are preparing to be engineers. So I want you to stop thinking, not stop thinking. That we live in a post-truth world, but don't stop thinking. Keep fighting. So stop thinking technical. I want to urge you to stop thinking technical. And I want to demonstrate to you today with some of the work that we are doing around smart grids, which are primarily thought of a technical object, to give you examples of why you should stop thinking technical. Okay. So you might remember earlier this year there was a big power cut in Amsterdam. A lot of my colleagues were late. A lot of my students didn't turn up in the class. There was another power cut in San Francisco recently, in Karachi, and a couple of years ago in India in 2012. There was a massive power cut which affected 700 million people in India at once. And a lot of this happens because the grids are overloaded. The grids are old, they're overloaded because demand often exceeds supply, and the grid is not able to fulfill that. A lot of people connected to the to these kind of interconnected central grids also are often not paying money for the grids, or not able to pay money for their electricity, which also leads to kind of demand-supply mismanagement, a lack of accounting, and then often these kind of breakdowns, massive breakdowns, manifest out of that. And smart grids are seen as a solution to this thing. By embedding a lot of ICTs and technologies within the existing grid, this demand supply management can be done. People who are not able to pay money or are not paying money can be cut off from the grid automatically, and these things can help our energy system, specifically the electricity grid, to become more stable. And of course, it can also help embed green energy into the electricity system, which hopefully someday will also be free energy, as the earlier speaker talked about. So smart grids are a solution to this kind of demand supply destabilization of grid. But there's another angle. These 700 million people who lost, who were affected by power cut, this is a fallacy. Because in India, when this massive power cut happened in 2012, it did not affect 700 million people. Because a lot of people like this household never had access to energy. They were never connected to the grid. So when this power cut happened, I was working in this area, and a lot of people that I was working with and myself found out about this massive power cut which affected 700 million people next day through newspapers. Yeah. So smart, and we think of smart grid as also something, as also a solution to this lack of access to energy that affects large parts of the global south. So at the moment, around more than 1 billion people lack access to electricity in the global south, and smart grids can also provide electricity to these people. And most of these people are typically ones who are living on the margins of the society and margins of economy. So really poorer people. And that's when we need to start thinking about smart grids are not really technical. Smart grids are actually socio-technical, because there is a major social angle to smart grids. A lot of these people who have low payment capacities, who currently don't have access to electricity, who live on the margins of the society, smart grids also need to be designed for them. And so what we think is that smart grids, so when we say smart grids are socio-technical, what we think is that we think of, there's of course technical smartness that we think of, but we also think of social smartness. Can we think of ideas of what that we can call social smartness? Financial smartness, we think of ideas which could be called as financial smartness. And governmental smartness, all of this needs to be governed and kept in place. So we think of also governmental smartness. And this is what we are trying to do in our project called Smart Grids in India. This is a NWO-funded project, a four-year project in which we are one year through now, that me and my colleague Johanna Hofkin, who's also here, we work on along with other colleagues in India, but also private Dutch companies who are developing technologies and want to commercialize this in India. But we want to think of a broader agenda which includes technical, social, financial, and governmental smartness. Because if we forget all of this and just focus on technical, then we will be overlooking aspects that do not contribute to energy justice, meaning energy equity. How can we provide more energy to more people who currently don't have energy and currently don't have the same kind of payment capacity that we all have, right? So we need to think of that also. But how do we do that? How do we reconcile this struggle of needing money to run these things, but also people who don't have as much money to pay to us? And that's when these kind of other ideas could help us in that. So for example, if you think of this technical device called smart meters, which are becoming really integral to how smart grids are designed, and these can automatically account for a customer's usage, balance the demand and supply, and automatically cut someone off if they haven't paid their bills or if they exceed their kind of energy account in a way. But what it also does is that it disconnects poorer people who often struggle with timely payment or payment for their energy services. And then it disconnects our idea of energy equity. How do we reconcile this if we only focus on the technical, like this smart meter? So there are other ideas that we need to think of and the other ideas that we need to look into. This technical idea can stabilize our energy grid, but what it will do is that it will convert this person who's temporarily not able to pay for his electricity from having access to modern electricity to having no access to modern electricity. And that we need to think carefully about that. So we need to think of other ideas. Some of these ideas that we have started encountering in our work, in our field work in India, and I want to introduce you to a couple of these ideas which can help us here. And there's obviously other stuff that's there, and we are working on a report which will talk about a lot of this other stuff also. So some companies in India are using a concept called joint liability group. This is a socio-economic concept, and this concept has been used for a long time in microfinance institutions. So essentially what it means is what it says. The liability for payment is taken jointly by a group of people, not one individual. And they are responsible for paying the bills together. So 8 or 10 people come together in a group and they say that we will pay as a group rather than as individuals. So what happens is that if one person or two people are not able to pay in a month, in a particular month, the rest of the group comes together to pay for them. And that way the energy company is able to make its money, the grid is more stable, but also the access to electricity for a lot of these poorer people is maintained. And this kind of long-term reliable access to electricity is quite important if we want to achieve development goals like using electricity to progress development goals like better health, better education and livelihoods to people. So we need to think beyond technical. And this joint liability group is currently, companies argue that it's benefiting them to collect money on time, to stabilize to manage their demand and supply, but also for people to maintain their electricity access. So this is what we would call social smartness and financial smartness, going beyond the technical smartness. And this you could combine also with a smart meter. So smart meters can give a company comfort that no one is going to use more electricity than they should. And whereas combining it with this social and financial smartness, they also make sure that people are able to maintain their access to electricity. Another idea that we came across was about public services. Because electricity is often linked to payment and how the grid can only supply electricity to amount of electricity that it can account for. So who pays for public services, right? And no company in these villages is ready to give public services like street lighting, because they don't find anyone to pay for it. But public services are important because they take energy access agenda further. because it gives comfort for people to move around in the evening, especially for women, and other kind of benefits. And some companies are now making an effort to also to start giving street lighting, because it helps them in two ways. One, that it, of course, progresses the energy access agenda, so it makes the project better. But also that it helps them embed the project within the community, because the community see that the company is taking a step further, going beyond just the crude economics, and they are thinking of the society also. But of course, this is not for free. A lot of these companies which provide public lighting, they embed the cost of public lighting into the electricity cost for individual households, with which they can also make money. So that, again, is something that we would call social smartness, going beyond only thinking about technical, right? So that's the main message I wanted to give you today. And I hope these examples make it clear and they help you think that you should stop thinking technical and start thinking socio-technical, right? Bringing the social and technical together. And that's where I'll stop. Thanks a lot.